The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Batch of workbooks that go with the new ancient blueprint for the supernatural book about the Didache, the training program for Gentile believers, written by the apostles. And it says, the lost teaching of the apostles, hidden for such a time as this. Well, we now have workbooks. And the way this came about is that I thought, you know, it's really good to have something to in your hand. When you're working through a program, it's easier to have a guide, a teacher, a class, something to help you study and really learn material. And of course, in this, it's the way of life in the Didache, so it's practice living this out. And so I had thought about a workbook, but then suddenly in our prayer time a couple of weeks ago, God gave me a download on how to do it. And we just received these from the printer. And there are a few of them at the back table. We encourage you to take a look, and some of you might want to get a copy and work through it on your own. Of course, it starts with some of the basic how-tos that we teach about getting in the presence of God and all that. But then it takes you through the commentary and overview of the six chapters of the Didache section called The Way of Life. And so I encourage you to take a look at it.
Our book's available, An Ancient Blueprint for Such a Time as This. Just knowing Christians, I'll explain a few things up front. First of all, the Didache is not Scripture. Say that back to me. The Didache is not Scripture. Just like my sermon outline is not Scripture, it's an outline to present Scripture. And that's really what the Didache is, the blueprint. And it was used, and oh yeah, here's the other thing. It's not Catholic. because it's old.
Okay, a little history lesson here.
This was hundreds of years before there was such a thing as Catholic. Okay. Before the New Testament was written.
It was the Didache was an outline that was spoken of by the early church fathers, the ones who knew were eyewitnesses of the apostles personally and mentored by them and the ones in the generations after. And they talked about the teaching, and they're about between 6 and 10 times in the Bible and the different epistles, it talks about the teaching of the apostles or following the apostles' doctrine. Well, it's believed that they're talking about the Didache, which was a training outline prepared for the Gentile believers when they started coming into the church. For the first 8 or so years of the church after the day of Pentecost, they were all Jewish believers right there in Jerusalem. It had never occurred to them to plant a church anyplace else. And then suddenly God sent Peter to Cornelius, and Gentiles started coming into the church.
Oh my goodness, now, Gentiles, people that had no training whatsoever and had a culture that had many gods, and all of a sudden now, and the scriptures haven't been written yet.
And no sense of morality.
And there's no sense of morality, no. So they needed, oh, what are we gonna do with these people?
Can you imagine, I just want you to think, as a church leader, suddenly you have all these ignorant and immoral Gentiles coming in. If you don't think they were ignorant and immoral, just read the book of Corinthians. This was Paul's reaction. Oh, my goodness. And so the Didache would have been available for Barnabas and Paul to have taken on their missionary journeys. And it was it's essentially a teaching outline that very closely follows what was later written in the book of Matthew. So, but this is a time when this was a Jewish movement within Judaism. Amen. They had not split. They were just living out their covenant as Jews following their new Messiah who'd burst upon the scene.
So you had the Old Testament training because they were Jewish. They had 10 commandments. They had a moral foundation. But when these Gentiles came along, they had to break the 10 commandments down to about 100 because it was like you had to feed them like little bit at a time. And like, no, don't leave your little girls out in the cold to die just because they're a girl. We're not going to do that. All right. Instead of thou shalt not murder. They had to break that down into all these little bite-sized pieces. Don't abort. Don't kill a baby after it's born because it's a girl. You know, they had to basically give it little teaching.
And Paul had to amplify it, and you can't sleep with your stepmother.
Yeah.
Remember, that was the big thing in the Corinthian church. Don't do that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And
okay. Go ahead.
So actually later, if you look through the history.
Does she have a microphone? She's taking over.
When Paul went north of the Mediterranean and went up to Ephesus and Smyrna and all those cities up there, part of our history that is not talked about in our churches was that John Mark went to the south down to North Africa and established the Christian school. It was like the Christian Ivy League University in Alexandria, Egypt. And many of those who were active in educating believers came from North Africa. And what is now, what was Libya, the countries down there. And the Didache, which was just short, about 2,000 word outline, was amplified and was found in what was later the Apostolic Constitutions, the Didascalia, Apostolorum, different documents of teachings for believers, their school program.
We've got the Bible now. We don't need that.
Let me cover Catholicism.
She's going to tell the story first.
Okay, so this is taking place in the first and second centuries when the church was new. Catholicism didn't come about until the late 300s or 400. So the Didache is a Jewish document written for Gentiles, has nothing to do with Catholicism. And who was here when we taught on the Wesleyan Quadrilateral? How to check for truth. John Wesley considered the Methodists essentially heresy proof because of the way he taught them. It was a grid to run truth by. First of all, John Wesley looked back to the early church, the pure church, and barely even considered any writings after the second century. And one of the tests for truth was, first of all, is it in the Bible? That's our first big test for truth. And he taught how to interpret the Bible properly, too. You don't take a scripture and twist it into a strange meaning, and you look at the whole canon of scripture to get the interpretation. Next, you test it by, can you experience it? Can you experience being born again? Can you experience being baptized by the Holy Spirit? Can you experience spiritual gifts? Sure, it's not just how many angels can dance on the head of a pin or some weird teaching that doesn't apply in real life. Christianity is ultimately about what is real and what can be experienced. The next test, and I consider one of the most crucial, does it pass the test of tradition? And by tradition, Wesley meant you go back to the apostles. You go to what the apostles taught. You go back to the eyewitnesses, the early church fathers, and that those that they mentored, who were the generation later. And if it wasn't taught then, you must reject it. And so, I hate to say this, But by the way, the Catholics were very, very upset by the Didache because it teaches adult baptism only. After going through a lengthy apprenticeship, that at first they baptized new believers immediately. But then, within a few short years, once the Gentiles started coming in, they were required to go through a lengthy apprenticeship and learn the way of life and live it before they were able to be baptized and join the Messianic community. And then Wesley's fourth test was, does it make sense? Is it logical? And those four tests, you can look at things that have been added in the church later on, and you can test your own theories that come up down the pike. And by the way, this is excellent too. When we do have a harvest and have a lot of young people coming in the church, the Methodist camps teach their young people how to use the Wesleyan Quadrilateral. Wesley didn't call it that. It was called that by other people who studied Wesley. The Wesleyan Quadrilateral, to get a solid theological foundation so they can stand, because there's more weirdness being taught now than it's, well, the late Steve Hill, the evangelist Steve Hill at the Brownsville Revival, he wrote a book called Avalanche about the heresies that are coming in the church and what our young people are believing. And we need to train people to be heresy proof, to follow John Wesley's example, to teach the creeds and the quadrilateral. And
actually, that one course we do, I believe that's very healthy for the church, because it's got the creeds in it. There are many essentials in the song. You start singing it, it starts getting written on the tablet of your heart.
So what I would do at the time, well, first of all, it talks about the apostles' doctrine before Cornelius was brought into the church. And I'm sure that I have my own ideas about what they were teaching the new Jewish believers after the day of Pentecost. But the very first thing I would do would be make training materials for the new people coming in. And I wouldn't leave it up to chance. I would make something small that was easily transportable, the size of a booklet like the Didache, that could be written on a few sheets of parchment and taken around to the different cities, the different Gentile cities, with them. And to tell you the truth, I believe that Matthew left a major imprint, because things were later written in the gospel. Oh, this was before all the gospels and epistles. This was written before 50 AD. But
that's another important point. Before 50 AD.
I think it was
so
more like 40 AD.
Before there were popes, and okay, because people get their timelines really messed up. Isn't that right? Catholic?
And it's been called the best window on the early church ever found in history. So, and it does teach tithing, by the way, as well as no infant baptism. And guess what? Remember all the wars they fought over baptism and how to do it? Well, other than baptizing as an adult who has been through the apostles' training, you can baptize in cold water, you can baptize in hot water, you can baptize in running water, if there's not much water, you can baptize by sprinkling.
If you're out in the desert, you can take it and pour it over their head. It's a heart transformation
right.
That's most important, not method.
How many wars we have avoided if we'd had the Didache? Anyway, I think it's absolutely fascinating, and I think God has revealed it and is bringing it to the forefront for the time we're living in. We're like Esther's for such a time as this.
But the two standard arguments are, well, we already have Scripture. That's all you need to teach is Scripture. But what would you rather do, hand somebody the Bible or show them how to apply the Bible in a methodic way to get the most out of it? Like, instead of just handing somebody the Scriptures, I would use this outline and start out with, you know what scripture I would start with before I start with anything? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength.
and love other people.
Instead of just reading, I'm reading Kings, and I don't understand why this guy shot arrows, and I don't know. All right, say, if you started with the love commandment and the things that Jesus said, all of the prophets hang on these two, to love the Lord your God and one another, that's where they started. So I would say, rather than just, of course you teach the scriptures, you don't add to the scripture. That's the other thing. Are you adding to the scripture?
The purpose of this is living the scriptures. And I must say, I do not see very much of that.
Right.
But just the one.
If we had a huge harvest right now, you would be starting from scratch with a lot of people because of the cultural influence. You would have to start out, no, there's only one God, it's Jesus, okay? And we're going to worship him and love him with all your heart. And like they did in the Didache, they would say, you're going to love the Lord your God, the God that made you. Are you going to be willing to die for him? Think it through. It's a major life decision. At that point in time, people were dying. And keep in mind, these people did not have the New Testament. They had the teachings from Jesus himself. They were alive. And they had the Old Testament.
Yes.
All right? They had the Old Testament, and they had Jesus' teachings by word of mouth. And they turned the world upside down before they had it. Think about it. There had to be something that these anointed 12 apostles who had been with Jesus are telling people before there was a written Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and various epistles. No, we don't need any more scripture outside of the canon of scripture. But at the same time, we need to understand that we need some kind of an outline to truly help people. You need Bible school courses. You need outlines. A sermon has an outline. We're not adding to the scriptures by having a sermon outline. You follow what I'm saying? It's for the purpose of teaching and training and equipping saints in the things that here, this is the priority. These other issues may be not relevant to any great extent, but here is a progression. And you know what's interesting is they taught you that not only do you love God, but you got to love people next. Does that make logical sense? Now, we all have scripture for this, but I don't know that you hand a new believer a Bible that they're going to go right there. I think they need a little bit of instruction. And I think that when we see a huge harvest, they're going to need some step-by-step instruction on where to start. Read the Bible, yes, and we don't need anything other than the Bible as far as instruction. But at the same time, you may need some outline to follow in a blueprint that will take you to the end result of a quality disciple, which happens to be the title of the sermon. That's Jennifer's cue for, okay, Jennifer, that's enough. My turn. Well, she's the historian. But those are common misconceptions. And I'm excited today to talk about the things that I've seen over the years and what I would call an exemplary disciple. What would an exemplary disciple be? Better than average? Exemplary disciple. What would an exemplary disciple look like? Plus, I also believe the day's coming when God's going to basically, if there's a huge harvest, everybody's going to be helping somebody because they're going to need some baby steps. But baby steps of obedience builds spiritual authority. It builds character. It builds maturity. And God wants us to grow up. There's some examples of exemplary disciples. And we know that the gospel, God chose preaching of all things, the foolishness of preaching, to get that word out. That's his choice. That man didn't pick that. God chose the foolishness of preaching to get the message out. But with the message that comes out, an exemplary disciple doesn't just have the right words, but has the right authority and the power on that word. We talked about this previously with there's words that communicate, and then there's words that have authority. Authority or power. Let the preaching of the gospel be not just in word, but power. Paul even said, those people that are puffed up, wait till I get there and I'll see that if their word has any power to it. Okay? There's a difference between anointing and just the right answers. You know, you could, unsaved people could read the Bible as a book, you know. But what God's basically saying is, Jesus was an exemplary disciple of his Father. He was perfect, right? But there are levels of communication, and the most profound level of communication, and this is for you and I as well. Jesus told Peter, or Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. There's an exemplary disciple. It's not like, you heard what I said. He didn't say just by my teaching. He said, if you've seen me, my behavior, the way I live, the life that I live, the death that I died, even, was a form of communication that was an expression. The highest form of communication is not in words, but the expression of those words as a lifestyle. In other words, a demonstration. And we need to prepare the body of Christ for what lies ahead, because it says, the end shall not come until this gospel of the kingdom is preached throughout all the world. It's going to have to be more than lip service throughout the world. It's going to have to be demonstrated through all the world, that by your love one toward another, people might believe. Okay? So, Jesus was an exemplary expression of the Father. It was the words that he spoke and the life that he lived, not just one. It was the words that he spoke and the life that he lived. Jesus became to be an expression of the Father. And he trained his disciples to do the same thing. Now, quite frankly, I'm fully recognizing the fact that we really need more Holy Spirit, and we really need to press in further to God in intimacy. Because I saw these before the Holy Spirit was sent on the day of Pentecost, they spent years with Jesus and they still seemed a little bit clueless in some areas. No. So it's not like you can't learn everything by just the proximity. You're going to have to learn to apply it, and you're going to need the Holy Spirit to apply that word so it's written on the tablet of your heart. But his passion was for discipleship, and his passion should become our passion. That's not just for fivefold ministers. Fivefold ministers are supposed to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry, to put a fire in your belly to disciple and take somebody, even if it's baby steps. Come on. You run into people all the time that are totally clueless. But you know what? We've had people come to the church because they were exemplary disciples. People wanted, they saw a changed life, which may mean at times you weren't really walking that well, then suddenly you start walking really well, and they go, where do you go to church? All right? A changed life is an expression that really speaks. There's people with lots of information and no changed life. That's not very impressive, is it? Have you ever gone for counseling to someone who's depressed? I've never done it. I don't recommend you do it if they're depressed. I'm not going to seek them out. I want someone that's in victory. Don't you? I want to talk to somebody who's in victory. All right, so a good discipleship produces an exemplary life. And what we've emphasized is that you need the Bible, you need to know what you believe, and you need behavior to model the Bible. Uh-oh, here we go. This is where we lose everybody. You mean I have to behave according to the Scriptures? Not just know them in my head and be able to recite them? Yeah, you need to exemplify it. Some people call it this early Didache before they had the Scriptures. They had Old Testament Scriptures, but they called it an extension of the Great Commission. They said, basically, we've got these people and we got to tell them about Jesus. What are we going to tell them? Well, I would start out with the basic. Break down the Ten Commandments in little bite-sized pieces and teach them that. Love the Lord your God, the God that made you. And even that would need explanation, because you say, you know those other nine gods you got? No, we're not going to go there. We're going to go, the God that made you. All of those are dumb idols. Jesus and a personal relationship with you. You shall love him with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. All of that is scriptural. You can find this in the Old Testament. So what the Didache did was, it took the teachings that Jesus said plus the Didache, actually raised it higher and brought it to where your behavior is going to need God. You're going to need the Holy Spirit to live this out. And but apprenticeship was the concept that they had in the early church. And we're going to have to get back there. Everyone's going to have to see themselves as somewhat of an apprentice. You know, we're not all knowledgeable in all things, but what we do know, you can reproduce. And anything that's worked for you, not just theory, anything that's worked for you in the kingdom of God, any scriptures that are real to you, you share that with other people. Most of you have certain scriptures even written in the front of your Bibles, if you're one of those kind, and you make little notes. Those scriptures had pertinent meaning, and I call them railroad track scriptures. They're probably good for you to go back to periodically to get you back on track when you kind of get off track. Go back to those original scriptures that God gave you. Experiencing in that early church was like being apprenticed to a master in a field. Like if you were going to learn to be an electrician, you would go study under a seasoned electrician. The day's coming when people are going to come to you and they're going to need ground level, bit by bit, baby steps. And even like in doing some teachings, you know, whenever Jennifer would say, we got to go granular. I said, and sometimes that's the way we all feel. Like we've been in the church for 30, 40 years. We don't want granular. We got to go to baby food. But you're going to have to be prepared to find an adequate way to express that in a granular way to someone who has no foundation. And there's no other foundation than Jesus. I was shocked at how many people think, we got the Bible now, what do we need to dedicate? We're not adding to Scripture. We're not adding to it. We're outlining the Scriptures for baby steps. If I had if suddenly there was a huge influx of Christians from our culture who've had no background in church, I would not teach them the Ten Commandments. I would break the Ten Commandments like in the Didache. I'd break it down to about 20 or 30 different little items and say, this is good, this is bad. This is pleasing to God, this is not pleasing to God. And just because you know it now, don't assume that you're going to hand somebody the Bible and they're going to grow. And one man even said, you know, if the church did its job, we wouldn't need Bible schools. I'm saying we're going to have to kick it up a notch from the Bible schools. And whose responsibility is that going to be? Well, fivefold ministers are going to have to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry and not give baby food, but give the meat of the word so that a person can take what's real to them and break it down into granular baby steps for people. But I like the idea to what they did. Keep in mind, they had no New Testament scriptures yet. But these early Jewish apostles had an encounter with Jesus on the day of Pentecost, filled with the Spirit of God, signs and wonders. And all of a sudden, it's like learning a foreign language. You know, Jennifer taught me that she was fluent in French. And the best way to learn is total immersion. We need people who are totally immersed in the Christian walk and talk of life. It needs to affect every area of your life. This isn't something for church on Sunday and then you drop it and put it on a shelf. This is meant to, how do you apply this in business? How do you apply this in school? How do you apply this in your family? How do you apply this with your neighbors? How do you deal with unsaved people? How do you deal with Christians? It's like learning a foreign language. Total immersion is the way to do it. But even total immersion, I want an outline or a blueprint to follow so that I can see that I am actually moving forward and upward. Because practice makes permanent. Practice the presence of God. Practice that word becoming flesh. Apprenticeship was in the early church. Actually, if you look at even in the natural, an apprentice, there's a beginner, Then there's someone who becomes competent. And then there's one that we call a master. We should have that in the kingdom of God as well. We should have people that are being apprenticed. Then we should have people that are competent. What was that thing I used to talk about, competence? When you learn something new in the scripture, you are unconsciously incompetent because you don't know it. Then suddenly the truth hits you and you're going, now I am consciously incompetent. I was blissfully unconsciously incompetent, but now I've learned more of the word and now I am consciously incompetent. Oh, you mean I'm supposed to do that? How about the first time you heard of tithing? I bet that triggered some things in you. Tithe? That's frightening. But now you are unconsciously incompetent. And what it does is it works as a preliminary to deal with any greed in you. If you're truly putting Jesus first, then that will be a safeguard against greed. And you can be rich or poor and be greedy. It doesn't. Greed is a problem, and they wanted to put a fence or a protective. Deal with it when it's small. Start tithing, and you will deal with any overflow of greed. Now, real discipleship programs should include three main products. One, the Bible. And no, you don't add to the Bible. I get weary of people that say that. Nobody's adding to the Bible. You need the Bible. But I know a lot of people that have the Bible and they go, I read it once. Okay, you're supposed to be applying it with correct interpretation, and like Jennifer said, look up what the quadrilateral requires and test it. Because there's so many things that have come along the years and been added. I want to go back to what the first century church believed. And lay hold of that and evaluate properly. It's interesting that John Wesley said that because of teaching the creeds, that they were, for a season, really it was just a season, they were heresy proof because their people knew. That's why I like singing that song, I Believe. Because you might take it for granted and think that's superficial, but there's people that, really? I mean, there's going to be people coming in that aren't going to know the simple basics in the creed that we would all take for granted. So if you're going to essentially teach them the Bible, and you know what these early apostles did that just thrills me? Just think, they had Jesus on the road to Emmaus, Luke 24, on the road to Emmaus, Jesus preached to them. We don't know what he preached to them, but he preached to them from all of the law and the prophets as it pertained to him. Amen. Whoa, would I have loved to have heard that sermon. Yes. You know? And the books of the world can contain all the things that Jesus said and taught. And, oh, I would have loved to have heard that. He took all of the law and the prophets and they're walking. And then they said, did not our heart burn within us? You know why? Because the words that he was speaking had the anointing of expression attached to them. It wasn't mental information. It was life-changing transformation. And I'll bet that stuff was written on the tablet of their heart. And I'll bet some of that stuff they had to teach before there was scriptures in the hands of all believers. They had to teach them. Yeah. Here's what Jesus told us. The title of the Didache is the full title is the Teachings of the 12 Apostles. The Teachings of the 12 Apostles to the Gentiles. I see nothing but extreme love that all of a sudden they don't have our Jewish background. These are Gentiles and really clueless. And I thought it was even lovingly the way they said, to a Jew, you would say, to love the Lord your God, the God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. That would apply to a Jew, but it wouldn't apply to a Gentile. The Gentiles go to Egypt. I was never in Egypt. You shall love the Lord your God who made you. That cut through it, didn't it? The God who made you. I saw such a loving compassion the way they reached out to these Gentiles to get them founded, knowing that they're grafted in, knowing that they had the resources of the Old Testament to draw from, but they also had the reality of personal experience with Jesus himself, walking and talking and having taught them and then teaching. As a matter of fact, I don't think I've ever found anything in much in the Didache, even in the outline form. There's some strange things in there that sounded kind of like, what does that mean, if you just read it at face value? But most of it points to, I could hear scriptures in my head every time I read, mostly Matthew and some Luke. But I can hear scripture. You should be able to do that as well. You should be able to hear the scriptures when you read something. But anyway, so looking at it from the point of an apprentice, beginner, competent, and a master. And it has to do with immersion, knowing the Bible, but better than that, living the Bible would be the next example, how to live and experience the Bible. I can take scriptures and remember when they were impressed upon me, changed my life, and I believe those are the ones that I can express the best, the ones that are real to me, even the ones that you wrote in your Bible. You actually have an anointing on those scriptures, and when you repeat it to someone else, there's authority that goes with it because it's a testimony. You are overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of your testimony, and then loving not their life unto death. Crucify that flesh, walk in the Spirit, and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. By the way, did you know they were called, they weren't, at the time of the Didache, they weren't even called Christians. That's how old it is. There was no Bible yet. They weren't called Christian, but you know what they were called? These ones that started to turn the world upside down, they were called the people of that way. What way? The way they walked, the way they believed, the way they behaved. Followers of this Messiah, followers of this Jesus. They were called people of the way. So people say, I'm not Catholic. They weren't even called Christians yet. I think when they see halos, they automatically think Catholic. I don't know. But anyway. Could you imagine what it would be like if you found Jesus as your Messiah, you got impact, you got filled with the Holy Spirit, and you went, I never knew this existed, and then you have your Gentile friend who says, well, we worship Zeus and Diana and a few other ones, and you're going to lead them to the Lord. Where are you going to start? You can't have the scriptures yet. They didn't have the scriptures yet. Huh? How would you like to meet the God who made you? Whoa! Let me introduce you to the God that made you. He's above all other gods. They're all with a little g. Do you know the Romans wouldn't have given Christians a hassle if they would have just added Jesus along with the other gods? It was the fact that there is no other God. I am, he says in Isaiah. I am, the Lord your Savior, and there's none beside me. Well, that'll tip the apple cart of all your little religious items. And then to top it off, and you can see it even in this day and age, all through history, the meanest people on the face of the earth are an angry religious person. Have you ever run into an angry religious person? There's times I used to think, I'd rather deal with an unsaved person than a really angry religious person. Now, an exemplary discipleship. Is this hard enough? I told Brittany it was going to be a hard message. Is this hard? No. Okay, good enough.
Make it harder.
Make it harder. All right. So, we need the Bible. We need to live the Bible. And we really need to know what we believe. Because even these early disciples, when they were being mentored, They said, now, we're going to take you under our wing and we're going to teach you what the scriptures say and what Jesus said and what the scriptures said, nothing else. If you hear anything else, don't believe it. That's still good advice to this day. If it's not in the scriptures, don't believe it. You don't need it. And anybody that's trying to teach you otherwise, don't believe it. Now, lastly, after the Bible, knowing what you believe, your behavior. That is where the rubber meets the road, because your behavior is supposed to be an expression of what you believe. It's not just about head information, it's about heart transformation. Now we know the scripture says, bless them that curse you, pray. But you know what? That's an instruction that's supposed to actually take place. I bless those that curse me. I pray for those who would say ill will against me. You should do the same. You know what that makes you? An expression of something, something that, like, if you were to do that, like on the job, I knew a lady once that she did hospital visits to the elderly in their home, and someone blew their top, and they knew that they were going to do what we taught them, how to stay in the peace of God even while the person was gone, and it caused another person to take notice, and I'm a Christian too, but I want what you've got. I've never seen anybody that didn't have the meltdown in that kind of a circumstance. That's impressive, and that's the way we should be learning. We should be learning by example to live it and see that it's not failing to react, but rather to respond in the anointing of God. And you won't do it right 100% of the time, but what? Practice makes permanent. So God's looking for living examples. Now, I want to cover four things that are exemplary. This is the actual sermon. All that other stuff was fluff. All right. Four things. It's just something you could just make notes on. This is something you could write in your Bible. This is something that you can challenge yourself with. What would an exemplary relationship look like? Exemplary relationship. What would it look like? And this is the goal of discipleship. Exemplary discipleship would be able to say this. Acts chapter 4, verse 13. Here is an example of exemplary relationship. It says, now when they saw the boldness and unfettered eloquence of Peter and John, they perceived that they were unlearned and untrained in the schools, common men with no educational advantages. They marveled and they recognized these people were with Jesus. And Jennifer likes to explain in our book, right? You did good history on this. It can be misinterpreted as unlearned and untrained. Unlearned and untrained in the higher schools of thought, but they were taught from the time of child to know the scripture. Otherwise, it would have been foolish if Jesus says, have you not read, to a bunch of illiterate dummies, right?
All the boys went to school.
And they all learned to read and write, and soldiers in the military in that time and season, even outside of Israel, could read and write. So, but there are revisionists that right now like to give you the impression historically, I'm sure they'll do it in the movies, to show you that they're all ignorant fishermen, unlearned, which would have been a real disservice if Jesus kept saying, have you not read? Right? Like he said in the script, have you not read? No, none of us know how to read, you know. But then if we can teach and revise history that they were all stupid and untrained and unlearned, then we can diminish Jesus' authority and effectiveness. That's the role of a revisionist, to pull stuff out of history so that they get their point across. Well, anyway, But isn't it now they saw the boldness and unfettered eloquence? So for these untrained, they were pretty eloquent in decreeing and declaring what God was saying. The boldness of unfettered eloquence of Peter and John, they perceived that they were unlearned and untrained in the schools, common men with no educational advantages, but they marveled. They recognized these people with Jesus. You want an exemplary disciple? Have people know that you are with Jesus. I wish I could still do what I did when I was a baby Christian. Somewhere I must have lost it. I'm going to have to get it back. But when I was a baby Christian and I got filled with the Holy Spirit, I walked around unsaved people and they cried for no reason. The tears would come down of their eyes. Oh, we got to get back there, don't we? Huh? We have to release so much anointing that you make unsaved people not only nervous, but even cry. I had relatives that cried, and I wasn't preaching. I was just standing there. You get filled and overflow, flooded with God, like Smith Wigglesworth, flooded with God, thank God I'm flooded with God. Flooded and overflowing. That's an exemplary relationship, okay? What about your witness? What's an exemplary witness? Point two. An exemplary witness, Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name? Haven't we done many wonders in your name? And he's going to declare, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. What he's basically looking for is not mere talk, but an empowered life. And even the gifts and the callings are without repentance. He's looking for the people that would basically be able to, by their witness, again, be an expression. Not mere talk. I had a scripture. I don't have it now. There was a scripture in, I think it was the Message that explained it really well. But it says, or it talks about Paul telling the Corinthians, they think I'm not going to come there, but I think I'm going to come there. And I'm going to see if this person really has any power. He's got lofty speech, but I want to see if he's really got any power. It's one thing to have the answers. It's one thing to say the right stuff. But he wanted to see if they had any power. I'm going to check out their power because it's not mere talk. It's in the ability to transform lives. If it doesn't change a life, it's empty. It desperately needs a witness of changed lives, an exemplary witness. Thirdly, exemplary maturity. This is where I like to use the outline and the dedicated, take people step by step and to increase that level of maturity. In the Epistle of John, it's laid out very simple too. It says, I speak to you, little children. I speak to you, young men. And I speak to you, fathers. Those are three levels of depth in your relationship toward maturity. A young man, a child, a young man, and a father. That's progressive. You don't start out fully mature. Nobody starts out fully mature. But you are to move on to grow in grace and in the knowledge of God progressively. And there's some key graduation periods. There's some works of the cross that literally elevate you from one to the next level in a very significant way. You could be in the church 40 years and still be a child based on this standard. That's the unfortunate part. And we will have to deal with that. And again, the outline in the Didache is very beneficial for that because it'll take you by, let's look at your foundation and see if there's some cracks in the foundation. If you're one of those believers that have been around for a long time that says, I heard this recently from someone, basically, God, I love, it's these people I can't stand. Well, you know, right at the beginning of the foundation, you shall love the Lord your God and one another. You can't skip the one another part just because you say you love God, all right? And you will run into that. But that will keep you a child in the kingdom. You may not lose your salvation, but that immaturity will remain. God doesn't want you to remain in immaturity. If you're still talking about the same person for years now that did you wrong, you are still a child. You haven't even walked in the basic forgiveness of internal transformation, the love message of Jesus. Full stature is why we named the ministry Full Stature, is because our mission was always to bring maturity. Always. Not baby food. There's plenty of places you can get baby food. But the idea was to put a fire under mature believers and even give them the means or the how-tos to make some progress step by step, even if it's baby steps. Baby steps builds authority. Baby steps are good. Wasn't there a television program of baby steps? Some guy did a book, I don't know. But anyway, baby steps is significant because it's like going up a stairwell. Once you move to another level, you're moving forward and upward. All right? And after looking back on the various levels of the cross, I speak to you little children because your sins are forgiven. I speak to you young men because the word of God abides in you strong and you've overcome the wicked one. So the difference is you went from child, pray for me, my world's falling apart, the sky's falling again. Just like yesterday and the day before that. Okay. Eventually you move to, I'll pray for you because the word of God abides in me strong. I'll cast that out of you. All right. That's the young man. Sometimes even on a lot of your television personalities, I think they're still young men because the emphasis is on what they can do. But the real passion changes is when the heart of the Father wants to see the young men do it. They want to see the children become young men. They would rather watch their children play on the swings than them play on the swings. You're too big to be playing on those swings. Let the kids do it, all right? Teach them how to do it properly. Train them, mentor, apprentice. Train somebody. Here's the way, in hindsight, the Lord showed me a progression of intimacy with God. You can find this in our books, but I was so appreciative when the Lord just revealed this one time in a prayer time, and he gave me a backward glance of how I progressed in my prayer time, okay? And the first thing that he showed me was that to pray was to touch his presence. Before I hear a word, everybody wants a word. I got to hear God. I got to hear what God's saying to me. Well, how about be with him first? Commune. Because if you commune and you touch him, you will be aware of his nature. And then when he speaks, you'll know his nature from your flesh nature. That's how you practice. And then what I learned was God showed me that because I enjoyed that touch, that intimacy with him in my prayer time, touch led to embrace. And I went, whoa, that's even better than touch. I feel like not only am I pursuing him and touching his presence, but he's holding me now, and it's building strength. An embrace is better than just a little touch. An embrace is, oh, I can practice his. I open my eyes in my prayer time, and I still feel his embrace. Yikes, I didn't know we could do that. That's the way I experience it. Because before it was always like this, and then I feel his presence, and then open my eyes, I still feel his presence. He's embracing me. Even though my eyes are open, oh, woe is me, I'm growing. And then the third one was that embrace produced something. That is like in a Song of Solomon, his left hand is under my head and his right hand embraces me. He's holding me like this, but that embrace does something. It produces what most Christians are longing for, satisfaction. So touch led to embrace, embrace brings a satisfaction. Now, the satisfaction is very, I like this, this is good for me. But it has the essence of his love nature, which was always meant to be given away, it switches on you. Because you're so satisfied, you want to reciprocate. If somebody held you and embraced you, I think I'll hold them and embrace them back, you know? That's what I feel like doing right now. Well, satisfaction in the spirit does just that. It triggers in you a desire to satisfy his heart. And it's, oh God, but you can't, we love because he first loved us, so you can't give him anything he hasn't given to you. He doesn't want anything he hasn't given to you. We love because he first loved us. It's with that love that we love him. And I saw that as I looked into that, and I'm saying, that reciprocation, it's like, I don't want anything. And many Christians have reached this in their walk with the Lord where you're all I need. You're all I ever wanted. You're all, and really mean it. That everything else is way below the norm. It's not, I love Jesus, but I love my car, I love my boat, I love my job, I love my, you know, it's not all equal. It's all him and him alone. Everything else is an accessory. And then it says, this satisfaction points to something. Because you want to give it back? What's it pointing to? Philippians 1:9. Let your love abound. That means overflow. If you're really in that place that you want to return that satisfaction and you can't give him something you don't have, so you can't give God satisfaction if you haven't been satisfied by him first. We love because he first loved us. So you can't give something you don't have. So you give back and you feel this over abounding, flowing love toward him. It's not going to be wasted because you know what it's doing? There's a graduation taking place in here. You're moving from the young man to the Father. You're moving from that overflowing love is now taking you into the heart of the Father, the way the Father looks at his children. Overflowing, abounding love brings the heart of the Father. Now get this. Where do we go from there? Say you've got the heart of the Father. You've got the heart of a spiritual mother. What do? That heart brings many sons unto glory. And you can't bring them to something. You reproduce according to kind. You can't reproduce according to anything other than what you have. And you don't have anything unless it's been given. So what is the ultimate goal of the church? That Jesus ascended on high, gave gifts unto men, apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, for the equipping of the saints to do the work of the ministry, that we would bring many sons unto glory. We have to get there first, to that level of maturity, in order to bring other people to that level. We can't have children raising children. It's not healthy. Oh, they'll come to places of agreement, because I see it even in the body of Christ. All you have to do is look on Facebook if you want to really see bad theology. And you'll find plenty of people that will agree with something that's kind of far out. Yeah, amen, they go, amen. It's kind of scary. But at the same time, it's children. What they really need is apprenticed by someone who knows better to love on them and say, what about looking at it like this? And as you apprentice them, they can move from faith to faith, glory to glory, victory to victory, and you're discipling. So the challenge for Kingdom Life Church has always been exemplary maturity. And this is one for my leaders, particularly Stina, and she's not here, she hurt her foot. But I can remember many, many years ago, I know Stina's watching. Hello, Stina. many, many years when she was, way before she knew us, and they've known us for 20-some years. I think when she was very, very young, if I got it right, Cliff, God gave her a word of about an epistle. what's that? God says, you're going to be an epistle. And in reality, that's actually full stature in the essence. And all of my leaders basically are an epistle. John 14:9, we've quoted this before. Jesus said, I've been with you so long, and you've not known me, Philip. He who has seen me has seen the Father. But 2 Corinthians 3, verses 2 and 3, you are our epistle. This is Paul speaking to the Corinthians. You are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly, you are an epistle of Messiah. You're an epistle of Jesus, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on the tablets of the flesh, that is the heart. These disciples owned and expressed as a life message what they were taught. And you know, to this day, we have phone appointments. People call in for phone coaching and stuff. Take any one of my 9 pastors, and they will answer exactly to someone who knows nothing or knows a lot, doesn't matter. They will answer exactly the way I would answer without asking me. That's an epistle. They were apprenticed, and they are living epistles. Doesn't mean I know everything there is to know, but by golly, I don't hesitate for a moment to know even some of the house group leaders. Some are newer than others. I'm talking about people that have been with me for 20 years. All right, but they can answer everything the same way I would. You don't really need Jennifer and I really feel we did our job. They are a beautiful expression because they don't just have the right answers. They're living it and they're expressing it. They are living epistles. That to me is the exemplary word. So what Stina got when she was very young to be an epistle, that should be a challenge to every one of us, is to basically be an expression of that word that's in us, not just knowing it in our head, but being an expression of it, living it. So I know that we, at least, and the gifts vary in the church and their strengths and weaknesses, but by golly, I'm very proud of 9 pastors that all of them could answer with the how-tos, and that is a missing ingredient. We've had people that were saved 40 and 50 years saying, here's somebody, Dennis and Jennifer, telling us how to do what we already knew we were supposed to do. In other words, we're already biblically literate. We know what the Bible says. But here's someone telling us how to do it. And we still need that. And you need that. And fortunately, I feel like exemplary reproduction by our leaders. Not perfect people. I'm not perfect. They're not perfect. But by golly, there's adequate, better than adequate, exemplary reproduction. And that's what I want for each and every one of you. I want you to reproduce according to your kind. So the better your kind, the better you can reproduce. The more that you change and are transformed by the Word of God, the more you have to offer someone else. You can't give somebody something you don't have. Oh, you can give them information, but you know what? They're looking at your life. They need to see more living epistles. They're looking at your life. If they don't see change, we turned the world upside down in Jennifer's world just when we first got married. I discipled her in some of the how-tos. She applied the work of the cross in her own life personally and radically changed. All of her friends went, what happened to you? Can you believe that she was written off as too emotionally damaged? But I didn't hold her hand and baby her. I said, here's what you need to deal with. Here's what you need. But she was so hungry for transformation, she went for it. It's not about babying somebody. Even if they're a baby, you treat them in little doses. But you still don't do for them what they need to do for themselves. I'm going to close on that. You can't do for someone else what they need to do for themselves. They'll never mature. You're not doing them a favor. Doing for others what they should do for themselves is not Christian charity. So let's stand, have a word of prayer together. Father, I'm believing for to be challenged to an exemplary discipleship. I'm believing, God, that we're never too young, never too old to learn, to press into the presence and the power of God. I'm asking right now, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to do a deeper work of the cross in me. And I'm welcoming it. No more baby food, no more patronization. I just want a deep, rich work of the cross and the Word of God to flood me from head to toe. And I want those portions of Scripture that I normally skip and say, God, apparently there's something in me that needs that because I've been avoiding it. So Holy Spirit, start pulling portions of Scripture that we've avoided and say, God, teach me instead. I humble myself. Teach me those portions of Scripture that I've avoided. They're right there, but I've avoided them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.